بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا وطيبا مباركا فيه، وصلوات الله وسلامه على نبينا الكريم محمد بن عبد الله الأمين الذي بعثه الله تعالى رحمة للعالمين. Inshallah ta'ala, today we're going to deal with a topic that has been announced, and it is one of the important topics in al-Islam. It's one of the perennial aspects of the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal. And that is, we're going to scratch the surface, inshallah, concerning the topic of al-amru bil-ma'rufi wal-nahyu anil-munkari, which is translated as enjoining the good and forbidding the evil. And regardless of the language that a Muslim may speak, regardless of his ethnic background, regardless of his or her sex, male or female, the issue of al-amr bin ma'ruf and al-nahyu an al-munkar, enjoining the good and forbidding the evil, is something that everyone has a responsibility to try, inshallah azza wa jal, to get some understanding concerning the issue and to give it its proper concern. And that's why we're saying that we're only going to scratch the surface of the issue, because it is in reality a topic and a subject that is deep. It's like any other aspect of the forms of worship in al-Islam. The ibadat in al-Islam are all built upon and predicated upon knowledge. So a person who wants to perform the salat, he can't just stand up with a pure niyat, with ikhlas, and he just starts to pray, and he doesn't know anything about the rules and the regulations of a salat. The salat, like all of the ibadat in al-Islam, it has its correct method, it has its correct mode, and it's not left up to the vulk, the taste, the emotions, the speculation of the people. Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned in the Quran, وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ عَدْلًا وَصِدْقًا. Your Lord, He has completed His religion. He completed his religion, and he described it being complete in this ayat with two things: in truthfulness and in justice. Truthfulness and injustice. In another ayat of the Quran, similar to that one, Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned, وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ الْحُسْنَى. Allah's religion has been completed with الْحُسْنَى, which is the opposite of doing bad and doing wrong and creating problems. So, the ibadat and the worship in al-Islam, it has its way of being done. No matter how sincere a person may be, if he doesn't do it the right way, it's going to be thrown back in his face. It's going to be rejected by Allah Azza wa Jal. And this particular issue has been described as being half of the religion by some of the ulama of al-Islam. Al-amru bil-ma'ruf and al-nahi an al-munkar. Some of the ulama of al-Islam said that all of Islam consists of doing good and staying away from evil. Al-amr bil-ma'ruf, enjoining the good and leaving off of the evil. So all of the ahadith that come in this regard, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam talked about this issue and shed light on the issue and encourage the people to pay attention to it, all of those hadith, the ulama of al-Islam said that the religion revolves around this particular issue: al-amru bil-ma'ruf and al-nahyu an al-munkar. So again, to repeat and to emphasize, this is an ibadah from the ibadat of al-Islam. It has its proper way of being done. If it is not done the correct way, the person who is doing it or the person who is not doing it, There are going to be some problems, ramifications. And everyone who's sitting there, if you're a husband, your son, a wife, a daughter, your neighbor, you have people you work with, work for, you are not going to be able to exist except that you have some religious responsibility concerning al-amr bin ma'ruf and al-nahi an al-munkar. So again, let this not be the only talk where you hear it and then that's it. We spend 45 minutes, an hour, 15 minutes, inshallah, reminding ourselves of this issue, and then that's it. We have to go back and we have to try to go on the internet or get the relevant relative books to help us to understand how do we do this? How do I enjoin the good concerning my mother and my father? How do I enjoin the good concerning my wife and my children? How do I enjoin the good in this situation or that situation? How do I prevent the evil as it relates to my mother, my father, as it relates to my wife, as it relates to my children and my relatives and so forth and so on? Because no one is going to be exempt from having to face and deal with a particular time where it's a need for you to enjoin the good or to prevent the munkar. Concerning the importance of the issue, we already mentioned that the ulama of Islam said that the ahadith and the ayat that talk about al-amr bin ma'ruf and al-nahy al munkar, they said it's the whole religion. This ayat represents the whole religion. As Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, وَلْتَكُنْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ. Let there be a group from you. Let there be a group from you. A group of people from amongst you, يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. Let there be a group from amongst you who enjoin the good and they prohibit the evil. In that ayat of the Quran, Allah Azza wa Jalla didn't say in the ayat that everyone at any particular given time has to do an amr bin ma'ruf and nahi al munkar, and that's part of the fiqh of the issue. That in this sitting where we are right now, if there was a munkar or an evil that took place, it may not be the responsibility of everyone here to deal with it. The lady, she may be exempt from dealing with it because her voice is an aura. And it's going to be the responsibility of those people, like the men, to deal with it. It's like when the imam makes a salat. He makes a mistake in the salat. He is having problems reading the Quran, or he makes a mistake. Because the woman, her voice is an aura, it's going to be left up to the men to try to solve that problem first. So this ayat of the Quran that has the lam and amr said, let there be a group from you people who are going to do that. So those ulama of Islam said these types of ayats, and there are many, many, many. Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat lin-nas ta'muruna bil-ma'ruf wa tanhauna 'anil-munkar wa ulaika humul muflihun. Allah Azza wa Jalla said this ummah is the best ummah that has been brought forth for mankind. And it's the best ummah because it enjoins the good and it prohibits the evil. And those people who do that are the muflihun. So Allah Azza wa Jalla in that particular ayat, he described the condition of the ummah of al-Islam. The ummah of al-Islam. If this ummah were doing the things that Allah Azza wa Jalla made obligatory upon them, the way it was during the time of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions, then this ummah is responsible for governing the whole world. Not only their society, but the whole world. So whenever the Muslims are practicing the religion, they're going to continue to spread the tawheed of Allah and the religion of Allah and the knowledge of Allah and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam within themselves, also outside of their boundaries, giving Bani Adam an opportunity to come inside of the worship of Allah la sharika lahu. But also, al-Islam came and it mentioned in this ayat, if the people don't do this job, as those scholars of Islam said, then the ummah, if they fail to do this job, they're not the best ummah that has been brought forth for the people. And there are ramifications that we're going to come to, inshallah, azza wa jal, if the ummah were to abandon it. To show the importance, ikhwani, of al-amr bil-ma'ruf and al-nahi al-munkar, is that some people used to come to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a companion, Ubad ibn Samit, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that some people came to embrace Islam. And the Prophet, when people wanted to embrace Islam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would give them what is called the bay'ah, or the pledge of allegiance. He would take his hand and shake the hand of the person who wanted to embrace Islam, and he would take from him the pledge. And he would say different things. I take the pledge from you that you don't make shirk with Allah, that you don't murder people, that you don't do highway robbery. And he would mention things that were always important, things that were going on in their society. He never, ever, ever took the pledge from the people concerning something that was frivolous. For an example, I take the pledge that every time you have a guest, you give them tea. Because that's frivolous. That's something that doesn't even, it's not even important. If you want to give tea, give tea. You don't want to give tea, you don't give tea. He never took the pledge on something that was insignificant. It was always something that was big. He used to greet a group of people, and he would take the pledge of allegiance from those people based upon solely telling them, you come into Islam and I give you the pledge that you do al-amr bil-ma'ruf and al-nahy al-munkar, and you don't have any fear of anyone in that regard. Because that's one of the benefits of al-amr bil-ma'ruf and al-nahy al-munkar. One of the benefits and one of the proofs of it is that the people who do it, and they do it correctly, and they see a responsibility to do it, they know that there's going to be blame and censorship from the people. And that blame and censorship many times prevents people from doing al-amr bil-ma'ruf and al-nahy al-munkar. The individual knows his father, his mother, a relative are doing something that's not correct, or they're doing something that is against the deen. And the person will remain silent because they're afraid of sticking out. They're afraid of being the one who's drawing attention to themselves. So the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to take this pledge of allegiance to the people based upon al-amr bil-ma'ruf and al-nahy al-munkar, because he knew not everyone is cut out to do it. Not everyone is cut out to do it. It requires, for the people who are going to do it the right way, a level of iman and a level of strength. From the benefit of it is, it's one of the characteristics of the Muslims. The person who's a Muslim, he has many characteristics. He should be truthful. He should be patient. The Muslim should be clean. The Muslim should be an individual who is trustworthy. There are many, many characteristics in the Kitab and the Sunnah that have been mentioned concerning the people of Al-Islam. This is one of the characteristics of any and every Muslim. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, المؤمنون والمؤمنات بعضهم أولياء وبعض يأمرون بالمعروف وينهون عن المنكر. The believing men and the believing women, they're responsible. They're the awliya. They're the protectors and the friends of one another. They encourage the good and they prohibit the munkar. So in order for an individual to have complete iman and to be considered a mu'min or a mu'mina, as this particular ayah clearly indicates and suggests, and it was the tafsir explanation of those ulama who gave the tafsir of the Quran, complete iman dictates and necessitates that the person is going to be an individual who enjoins the good and he's going to prevent the evil. And that's elementary and fundamental. Al-mu'minun, they are awliya one to another, and that's because of those many ayat, innama al-mu'minuna ikhwa, the believers are brothers. Al-mu'min mir'atun mu'min, the believer is a mirror to his brother. The Muslim is going to see in his brother what that individual may not see in himself. Or he may see that thing in himself, but he needs to be reminded. So the nature of the brotherhood in Al-Islam is that we need to be in a position, in a situation where we're going to enjoin amongst ourselves, do this and don't do that. And there are a number of other indications from the Kitab and the Sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam that clearly show that. The mundane issue of sitting in the street, not so much the streets where we come from, like here, but in places where there are a lot of people, like Alam Rock and other places, Coventry Road. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told his companions, and he told us as well, iyakum والجلوس في الطرقات. He said, beware of sitting in the street. Beware. Don't be a person who just, you just chilling out, hanging out on Coventry Road or Alam Rock Road. Don't do that. The companions, when they heard that warning, they say, Ya Rasulullah, we have to sit in the street because we have to talk to one another. We see each other, so we have a meeting in the street and we just talk. So it's something that would be difficult for us if the religion made it impermissible for us to sit in the roadway. He said, okay, if you have to sit in the roadway, then give the road, give it its haq. They said, what's the haq of the road? He told them a number of things. He said, if you have to sit in the road, then make sure you give it its haq. And the haq of sitting in the road is to lower your gaze. The woman walks by or a man walks by, lower your gaze. He said also, don't harm people. Don't harm people. Don't do things in the roadway that going to be an impediment for the people to pass by back and forth. And then he told them, make sure you give salams if you're going to sit in the roadway. And then fourthly and lastly, he said, if you're going to sit in the roadway, make sure that you make al-amr ma'ruf and al-nahy munkar. That you may see things that are taking place in the roadway that go against the religion of Islam. So it becomes a religious responsibility for everyone to give to the Muslims. So the point here is, al-amru bil ma'ruf and al-nahyu an al-munkar, it is part and parcel from the characteristic that has to be inculcated within the being of the Muslim. He's a father, she's a mother. Just in the community, this is something that has to take place. But as I mentioned, and we'll come to that inshallah azza wa jal, after dealing with some of the important aspects of it, showing the virtues of it, it has to be done in the right way. Because if it's not done in the right way, an individual is going to create more problems than the ones that he wants to get rid of. Those that he wants to order with and those what he wants to prevent, it's going to be a bigger problem. Also, from what shows the importance of it, ikhwani, is the success or the najat, the success of the ummah, our community, the family, the masjid, the country, the ummah of Islam, the success of the family is diametrically connected to this issue of al-amr bil ma'ruf and al-nahy an al-munkar. If the Muslim ummah doesn't get involved and do something about what's going on in Iraq collectively, they don't do something about what's going on in Syria, they don't do something that's going on about what's going on in Egypt, the evil on whatever level it is, if the ummah allow people just to do whatever they want to do, then as a result of that, the destruction of the ummah is in that. And if there are a group of people from the ummah who take the responsibility to try to engage the community and command and enjoin the good and prohibit the evil, then the success of the ummah is in that. And there are many, many ayat and many ahadith of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam that show and indicate that. So from the importance of it, the fourth point from the importance of it is the success of your family, the success of your family. Your mother, your father, your brother, your sister, your uncles, your aunties, who are saying that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is hazir nazir. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knows the ilm al-ghayb. And they worship Allah doing shirk and innovation. The success of that family and the destruction of that family comes directly as a result of you not saying something or you trying to say something. If you say something, perchance, they'll listen and they'll change. As many of us changed. Some of us were kuffar, some of us were not practicing. Something sparked in the heart and the mind of different people who were here, something that caused that individual to make tawbah to Allah, to come to the realization that what they were doing was the wrong way. Because someone made an amr bin ma'ruf or a nahi an al-munkar. So whether it's the family, whether it's the community, whether it's the masjid, whether it's the country, whether it's the ummah, from the importance of al-amr bil ma'ruf and al-nahy an al-munkar is, if it's done, then the najat of the community is in it, and if it is abandoned, then the whole community is going to be destroyed. The whole family is going to be destroyed, or can be destroyed. From the dalil of that is what Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran,
أنجينا الذين ينهون عن السوء وأخذنا الذين ظلموا بعذاب بئيس بما كانوا يفسقون. Allah mentioned in that ayat, verily we saved those people who prohibited the munkar, the evil, and we took and we grabbed and we punished those people who oppressed the oppressors with a grievous punishment because of the fisk that they used to do. So the ayat mentioned two categories of people. Allah gave najat to the people who prevented the su and the munkar, and the oppressors who they were trying to prevent from doing whatever they were doing, Allah punished them with a grievous punishment. And the scholars who gave the tafsir of this ayat said, is worthy to acknowledge and to see and recognize that Allah Ta'ala was quiet about the people who are quiet. Those people who prevented the munkar, Allah saved them. The people who oppressed and did wrong, Allah punished them. What about the people who didn't say anything? The people from the community, they didn't do the evil, nor did they try to stop the evil. They were just quiet. Allah Azza wa Jalla sakata anhum. He didn't mention them. The scholar said the reason for that is because the reward that a person receives is comparable to the action that he did. If he was quiet, Allah is quiet about him. If he did good, Allah do good for him. If he did evil, evil will be paid back to him, and so forth, so on. And that's one of the things that happened to Bani Israel. This is important because part of our aqidah is what the Quran mentions and what the Prophet mentions, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, about Bani Israel, and that we're going to follow Bani Israel in everything that they did. One ayat, it mentioned, لُؤِنَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ عَلَى لِسَانِ دَاوُدَ وَعِيسَى بْنِ مَرْيَمَ ذَلِكَ بِمَا عَصَوْا وَكَانُوا يَعْتَدُونَ كَانُوا لَا يَتَنَاهَوْنَ عَنْ مُنْكَرٍ فَعَلُوهُ وَلَبِئْسَ مَا كَانُوا يَفْعَلُونَ. The people from Bani Israel, there was a group of them who were cursed on the tongue. They were cursed by Dawood and they were cursed by Isa ibn Maryam. And the reason why they were cursed is they did not prevent the people from the munkar. Fa'alu. Instead, they fell into the munkar. And Allah Ta'ala mentioned, it is a bad thing that they used to do. So from the Islamic narrative in the Quran and the Sunnah, we know and we believe that Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned in many ayat of the Quran that Bani Israel were turned into monkeys and some of them were turned into swine. Those are ayat of the Quran, and it's not allegorical. It's not permissible for a Muslim to walk around and to say to Jewish people, you monkey, you pig. It's not permissible to say that, to be nasty like that with people. That's not the dawah. And when our mother Aisha, radiallahu anha, said something similar to that when she became upset with a group of Jews who said something bad and nasty to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they wished death upon him. They wished harm upon him. And she said, may death be upon you. May harm be upon you, you descendants of pigs and monkeys. She didn't even say that they were pigs and monkeys. She said that they were descendants. They're people in the past. They're aslaf. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he heard that, he said, Aisha, don't say that. Don't say that. Don't talk in that type of a way. So the point is, we as Muslims believe in the Islamic narrative, the Quran and the authentic Sunnah, that that's something that happened to those people in the past. Doesn't mean that human beings came from monkeys. Doesn't mean that. But as a result of this ayat that we just mentioned, they were changed into some of their people from the disbelievers, not the meaning from them. They were changed into, turned into pigs and monkeys. Some of those ulama, like Al-Imam Muhammad ibn Jarir At-Tabari, Al-Imam ibn Kathir, and other than them, they said that those people from Bani Israel who were changed into the pigs, they were the ones who used to do the evil. They were the ones who started to do the things that their prophets and the messengers were telling them, don't do these things. Making shirk with Allah, murdering the prophets and the messengers, the ones who did the evil and they made the mubashara of the evil, Allah Azza wa Jalla changed them into pigs because of the evil of what they did. As for the monkeys, those ulama, the mufassirin, they said, the ones who were changed into the monkeys were the ones who remained silent. They saw the people making shirk. They saw the people drinking khamr. They saw the people committing zina. They saw the people eating and devouring riba and so forth and so on. They didn't do it, but they saw it. But when they remained silent as a result of that, Allah Azza wa Jal changed them into monkeys because of that principle that we mentioned a few minutes ago. Al-jaza'u min jins al-amal. Kama yaf'al al-insan yuf'alu bihi. As the person does, his reward is going to be comparable to that thing that he did. So for those of you who ever wondered, that was the tafsir and the ta'wil of some of those ulama who explained to us some of those ayahs of the Quran. Who were those who were changed into pigs? Who were those who changed into monkeys? The ones who didn't make al-amr bil-ma'ruf and al-nahy al-munkar. They were the ones who they resembled the monkeys who just imitate, and they were sakitin and they were quiet. During the time of the Nabi's companions, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, they used to take this issue very seriously. And as we mentioned, it is an issue, ikhwani, that requires some tafaqquh. It needs some comprehension and some understanding. Because al-amr bil-ma'ruf and al-nahy al-munkar, as we mentioned, if it represents the whole religion, as some of those ulama of al-Islam said, the deen yashmal, doing good, or staying away from evil. So it's the whole religion. So you can rest assured that an issue like this, it is something that requires knowledge and is not based upon guesswork and conjecture. So there are a lot of dawabit, there are a lot of shurut, there are a lot of issues that should be understood. And that's what we want to deal with right now. What are some of the regulations, the rules, the conditions that we have to know when it comes to al-amr maruf and al-nahy al-munkar? Many things can be mentioned, but at the top of the list, what I want to mention right now, at the top of the list, and I remind all of you of the importance of this, is that in doing this, like any other ibadah from the ibadat of al-Islam, it requires ikhlas. Because if a person doesn't have sincerity, if he doesn't have sincerity, he may think that he's trying to do al-amr bil-ma'ruf and al-nahy al-munkar, when in reality he's just trying to put people down. He's trying to put himself up. He's being judgmental and being nasty. And you can tell many times his niyyah by the way he deals with people. The Rasul of al-Islam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was the arham al-khalq. He had rahmah on the people. He had rahmah on the kabir, rahmah on the saghir. Little man is calm right now. Little man was walking around and stuff like that, making noise, distracting us and stuff like that. I want to enjoy the good and I want to prevent the evil. I say, hey, little man, and I poured a hot tea on him. Is that the way to do it? His father, his brother, whoever said it, he did like this emphatically. Don't do that to my brother, to my son. Don't do like that. So if I was sincere, I wouldn't do it that way. And that's why we have the scholars of Islam, ikhwani, like the great muhaddith and faqih of the Hanbali madhab, and he was from the students of Sheikh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimullah ta'ala, al-imam Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali. He wrote a book called Al-Farqu Bayn al-Nasihati wa Ta'ayyir. The difference between giving advice and putting people down. Exposing people. Don't get it twisted and misunderstood. Sometimes people have to be exposed. And that's the whole thing about being balanced in our religion and knowledge. Because if you were to look at some of the positions of the Salaf, you would think as sitter and just concealing is the way you should do it. But if you looked at others, other athar and examples, you may think exposing is the way to do it. But with knowledge, you come to know sometimes you expose and sometimes you cover up. So the point is, al-ikhlas. You don't give nasiha to people. You don't make al-amr al-ma'ruf and nahy al-munkar. It is not necessary, ya ayyuhas salafi. It's not necessary, ya Muslim, that every time we give dawah ilallah to name names and to name groups, it's not always necessary. Sometimes it's the best thing to do. But the asl, the way of giving dawah is not to name names. And that's why the Nabi used to say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ma balu aqwamin fa'alu katha wa katha wa katha. What is wrong with some people who did this and some people who did that? As you're sitting there, you don't know who did it, but the one who did it, he knows that the Prophet was talking about him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you start to say things to people, for an example, their leader of this particular jama'ah, every time they mention his name, they say so-and-so the shaheed. What you're going to say is the truth about his mistake or whatever. But as soon as a person hears that you mention the name in public, he feels like you're disrespecting him. If you know that that is what is going to be the response, you have to be able to weigh. It's better not to say that, because the goal and the objective is inqadh your brother from the adab of Allah, saving him from the punishment. It's about giving him a gift that he didn't know about, the ma'roof. So that's the first thing. Al-ikhlas, al-ikhlas. Number two from these issues that we want to mention is that al-amr al-ma'roof and al-nahy al-munkar is two types. One is fard al-ayn and one is fard al-kifaya. If some people do it, everyone is exempt. And if no one does it, everyone is sinning. And then there's the amr al-ma'roof, that's wajib upon you, you and me. Which brings us to the other issue. And that is, sometimes when we enjoin the good and we prevent the evil, it depends on a person's ability or lack thereof. During the time of the companions, radiallahu anhum, a number of companions were still living during the khilafah of Mirwan ibn Hakam. Mirwan ibn Hakam. That's when kings and stuff, they started to become the leaders of the Muslims. And there was some evil that was going on. And the companions were there, radiallahu anhum. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, may Allah be pleased with him. From those companions, the seven who narrated the majority of the hadith. He was a muhaddith, and he was from the fuqaha of the companions. He wasn't some regular companion. He was from the youngsters. He was from the Ansar, and he was young. When the Prophet died, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was like Ibn Umar, Ibn Abbas. He was like those people, Jabir ibn Abdullah. He was young. Anyway, Mirwan ibn Hakam, during his khilafah, the people didn't want to listen to his khutbah. They didn't want to listen. So you know, it's wajib to pray the prayer, and it's the sunnah to listen to the khutbah. This last Eid, Eid al-Adha, the people were out there for a long time, 9:30. Some people were out there 8:30, keeping that wudu until the salat actually happened. And then as soon as we said assalamu alaikum, they got up and they left. No problem. No problem. The hadith of Abdullah ibn Sa'ib, after the Prophet would make the salat of al-Eid, he would say to the people, inna nakhtu, faman arada an yansarif, falyansarif. Whoever wants to leave, let him leave. No problem. So this man, Mirwan ibn Hakam, in order to keep the community and make them listen to him, they all came out to make the prayer. His people brought the minbar out to the musalla, which is against the sunnah. They brought the minbar out to the musalla. And then he got ready to do the khutbah before the salat. He's going to do the khutbah. Some regular man in the audience said, Amirul Mu'mineen, can I say something? He said, yes. The man got up and he went to Mirwan ibn Hakam, and quietly between the Amir and that man, he said, Ya Amirul Mu'mineen, the sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam is that the salah should be first and then the khutbah. Mirwan ibn Hakam did this to the man. I mean, you better sit down before you lose your head. You better sit down. The man just went back and he sat down. He didn't turn to the audience and say, hey, I just gave him advice. He just went and he sat down. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri came and the people told him what happened. He said, لَقَدْ أَدَّ مَا كَانَ عَلَيْهِ. He did what his job was. His job was just to give advice the way he did. مَنْ أَرَادَ أَنْ يَنْسَحَ ذَا سُلْطَانِ فَلْيَأْخُذُهُ بِيَدِي وَلْيَخْلُو بِهِ فَإِنْ قَبِلَ مِنْهُ فَبِهِ وَنِعْمَةً وَإِنْ رَفَضَ فَقَدْ أَدَّ مَا كَانَ عَلَيْهِ. Anyone who wants to give advice to the leader, the father, the boss, someone is in charge, the imam, you want to give advice to the leader, then be secluded with him, take him by his hand, tell him between you and yourself, if he takes it, alhamdulillah, ni'mah. If he doesn't take it, you did your job. So this hadith goes to show, if you're going to do al-amr bin ma'ruf and al-nahyu an al-munkar, it depends on your ability. It depends on your ability. When Abu Sa'id, the companion radiallahu anhu, heard about everything, he told the people, I heard the Prophet say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, man ra'a minkum munkara, falyughayyirhu biyadihi, wa in lam yastati' fabilisanihi, wa in lam yastati' fabiqalbihi, wa thalika adaf al-iman. I heard the Prophet say, if any of you wants to stop a munkar, then let him do it with his hands if he has the ability. His child, his wife, his whatever. And if he doesn't have the ability, let him say something. And if he doesn't have the ability, let him hate it in his heart. And hating it in the heart is the weakest of iman. Another hadith said, behind that, وَمِنْ وَرَاءِ ذَلِكَ, whoever doesn't do that, then he doesn't even have any iman whatsoever. Some other important issues, and there are many, ikhwani, there are many. Concerning enjoining the good, al-amru bin ma'ruf, we have to know, number one, that the thing that you're enjoining is really ma'ruf, because it may not be ma'ruf. You have to have knowledge. At the khutbat al-eid, the people are getting up after the salat and they want to go. So the imam says to the people, hey, you people, where you going? Sit down and listen to me. I'm about to read the Quran and the ayat and I have something to say. So he enjoins the people with what he thinks is ma'ruf, but in fact, it's not ma'ruf. He has to have knowledge that the thing that he is calling to is actually really from the deen. It is ma'ruf, because the ignorant person, the jahil, la yatakallam, he shouldn't talk. Be quiet. Be quiet. Abdullah, everybody here knows that the woman has to wear hijab. A non-Muslim confronts you and says to you, what's the wisdom? What's the illah? What's the hikmah? Why is it that Islam says the woman have to wear hijab? You can give reasons for that from your own mind that are indisputable. And then the person says, okay, what about the men? Why you men? Why men don't have to wear hijab? Maybe you can't answer that with an intelligent answer. Maybe you can't answer. You don't have to feel like you're naqis, you're small. So just say, Allahu a'lam, I don't know. If you don't know, you don't know about something. There's nothing wrong with that. لَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِعِلْ. Don't talk about what you don't have any knowledge about. So that's the first thing. الْأَمْرُ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. You have to know that that thing is ma'ruf. Number two, you have to know that the person who you're advising and you're trying to tell him, you have to know that he actually really left off the ma'ruf. You can't guess. You can't assume. You have to know. The Prophet was given the khutbah, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. Look at our Nabi, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. A mu'allim, a murshid, rahim, ra'uf for the people. He's given the khutbah. As he's given the khutbah, he saw his companion come in. His companion's name was Sulayk al-Ghatafan, radiallahu anhu. He came in late while the Prophet was giving the khutbah. Rasulullah was talking, and he used to make eye contact talking to the people. So when he came in, he was talking. When he looked back, the man was sitting down. Now the Prophet knows, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the man should have been praying at that time, because he only looked away, and now the man is sitting down. He asked him, Ya Sulayk, asallayta rak'atain? Did you pray the two rak'ats to greet the masjid? He said, no, Ya Rasulullah. He said, qum fasalli rak'atain wa tajawwaz fihima. Get up and pray two rak'at and do it quickly. This small hadith in this incident is full of a lot of benefits for us. It goes to show, ikhwani, for our relatives who believe that the Prophet was hazir nazir. Hazir Nazir, he knows the ilm al-ghayb. These types of hadith consistently go to show that's kadhib, khurafat, shirk. It's not true. It's not true. Prophet Muhammad, in this case, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was actually in the same place with that man. They're in the same place. He was hadir, nadir. He was there and he saw the man. And still, he asked the question, did you pray two rakats? He wanted to be sure. The man left off the maruf. He just didn't start talking. He wanted to be sure. Hey, did you pray those two rakats? The man said no. Then he told the man, hey, get up and pray those two rakats. So before you start to command people to do things, you have to have knowledge. Did he actually abandon that particular thing? And so forth and so on. There are other things, but we have to move on. Concerning the munkar. Now this is where the big problem comes in, with the munkar especially. There are some conditions about the munkar. We have to know something. Number one is munkar with a dalil as shari. This is munkar based upon the dalil, not based upon emotions. Some of the jama'at and the individuals, the munkar to them is what is determined by speculation, what's determined by their emotions. It's munkar. By the dhuq, I feel it must be wrong. And our religion is not like that. You have to know. This thing is munkar because the dalil said it's munkar. Do you people know, ikhwani, we're living right now in a time where things are topsy-turvy. Haysa besa, upside down. Sinawat khadda'at. The sunnah now is bid'ah. And the bid'ah is sunnah. At-tawheed is shirk. And shirk is tawheed. I saw something someone sent me something about the Rafida of Bahrain making hajj. And doing the hajj. They were doing all kind of stuff, making istighatha with Hussein and Ali. And they were doing all kind of noise. It's hajj. If someone were to see them and they have no knowledge, someone may say, mashallah, look at the tanzeem. They have one voice. They look powerful. And everything that they're doing are things that will destroy a person's hajj. Making shirk, calling out other than Allah Azza wa Jal. So the person, he's a da'i and he gives da'wah to tawheed. He gives da'wah to tawheed. His books are about tawheed, kitab al-tawheed, and other than that, there are those people from our community who look at that as being munkar. Someone gives a khutbah about tawheed or something, not making shirk, not making an innovation, someone will stand up in the audience and make a nahi an munkar. And the thing that he's prohibiting is a tawheed, al-khalis. So we have to know that a thing is munkar based upon its dalil. Number two, about the munkar, number two, is that we have to understand and we have to appreciate as well that the individual has really fallen into something that was really munkar, just like the ma'ruf. Someone sees a person eating in the month of Ramadan. And I saw this happen in my own eyes on a number 8 bus where a lady was eating. She was an Asian lady. And some brothers got on the bus and they made inkar that she was eating Doritos in the daytime. And they were saying to her, why are you not fasting? It could have been the time of the month where the person doesn't have to fast. The Muslim lady doesn't have to fast. The person who's eating in the daytime during Ramadan can be a traveler. That could be a person who's sick and they have to get something in their body because of whatever. They have to get sugar in their body. In the case of this lady, she wasn't even a Muslim. She just looked Asian. And that guy made inkar on her. And she was a Sikh or a Hindu. And the guy made inkar on the munkar in front of everyone. And that's because I'm sure his iman, he was flying with the birds. You know how you're really... No, I don't mean it in that type of way. You know, hey Bilal, in the month of Ramadan, you know how we feeling good. You pray Salat al-Asr, and wow, Maghrib is close, and we're in Birmingham, we're in Small Heath, Alum Rock, the streets go quiet, and we're happy at that time. You know, we make a lot of mistakes, but Islam is the haq, and he's on the bus, and he sees the lady, hey, how can you eat that? So I'm not even a Muslim. So you have to know that the thing that the person is doing is actually a munkar. Again, knowledge, ikhwani, knowledge. Lastly, concerning the munkar, inshallah, we cannot prohibit the munkar, if when we prohibit that munkar, it's going to create a bigger munkar. Something is going on. There is munkar. The wife is dealing with a husband who's fallen into munkar. If she tries to change it, it's going to create a bigger munkar. She's going to get attacked physically. She's going to get divorced. She has to be able to weigh that situation. Allah said in the Quran, وَلَا تَصُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ فَيَصُبُّ اللَّهِ عَدْوًا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. Don't curse the gods or the people who worship other than Allah. Don't curse their gods. Don't curse their idols, Sikhs, Hindus. Don't curse the cross. Because if you do that, you may cause them to curse Allah Azza wa Jal. Al-shirk, la'natullah is on the shirk. The la'na of Allah is the malaika, the rusul, the anbiya, and the people have the ability to make a la'n. They make la'n to these things that are worshipped other than Allah. بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ. No doubt. And they deserve that you say la'natullah. Deserve, it's the haq. But if you're saying, may the curse of Allah be upon that, this, that, is going to cause that person to curse Allah, that's a bigger munkar than what they're doing. So Allah said, don't do that. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he conquered Mecca, he was looking at the people going around the Kaaba with our mother Aisha. He said, ya Aisha, if it wasn't for the fact that your people, Quraysh, are new to Islam, these people just embraced Islam in Mecca, he said, I would have taken the door of the Kaaba, I'd have lowered it where it was during the time of Ibrahim. Ibrahim, when he rebuilt the Kaaba, there was a door on the ground and another door on the ground. Anyone can go in and come out. Slave, white, black, Quraysh, other than Quraysh. But when Quraysh came, they changed it. And they put the door up so that only the nobility of Quraysh can go in and out. And no one else can go in and out unless they said it was okay. So the black person, forget about it. Forget about it. You're not going to the Kaaba because Quraysh were racist. Non-Qurayshi, you're not getting in that Kaaba unless they allowed you. Now, it was the haq for the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to take the house of Allah and to put that door on the ground the correct way. But if he would have touched it, the new Muslims, because they are new to Islam, they would have said, look at Muhammad. He has disrespected the Kaaba. That is a sacrilegious act. That is an act that is not acceptable. Someone goes into a church, one of our relatives. He goes into a church, and in any church, they have all of those candles lit, 500 candles. You go into the church, one of our relatives, one of our youth, he goes and he vandalizes the church. He knocks over the candles, and he spray paints inside the church, La ilaha illallah. We're going to say, what are you doing? What are you doing? We're going to be upset with him because that's not da'wah. That's not how you behave. That is a sacrilegious act. Although those people are making shirk and kufr, you can't go to the Sikh temple and burn their flag. And you can't do that stuff. So if the munkar is going to create a bigger munkar, then you don't do it. So this third point, ikhwani, this third point helps us to understand. The third point, that when we want to make inkar and we want to prevent the munkar, four things can happen. And each one of those things would determine whether we do it or not. The first thing is, you completely have the ability to eradicate and to eliminate the munkar. It's wajib to do that. You have the ability to completely stop it. Now it's wajib for you to do that. Second thing is, you have the ability to make the takhfif and the taqleel. You can minimize it. You don't get rid of all of it, but you got rid of a lot of it. It's wajib for you to do it. Wajib. You didn't stop them from doing everything. At the graveyard for the relative and the janazah, they do their stuff. But when they come to our house, they're not going to do any of that stuff. So we're going to do it in our house and we're not going to do it over there. But we made it minimize. Wajib. Number three, the munkar that you want to stop may turn into a different munkar altogether. And this, there's another. Some of the ulama say you should stop it. Some of the ulama say you shouldn't stop it. Those who say you should stop it, they said you should stop it because if you stop that particular thing, you stopped it and went to this thing over here, maybe it's going to be less. Maybe they're going to leave it. You know, ihtimalat. It's philosophical kalam. And then the fourth point, the fourth condition, is that the munkar becomes bigger. In this case, you shouldn't do anything. Let it happen. Just let it happen. Ikhwani, in Manchester, some of our brothers on the sunnah, they're rough and tough. They have ghulu. 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 Bima'na al-kalima. The mother of two of the brothers died. The mother died. The mother. One of the brothers, he's mutsheddid ghulu. The other one, he's balanced. The elder one is balanced. More easier. More intelligent. More responsible. They decided that the masjid of the rough and tough people would be the masjid that does the janazah. And when they went, it was problems with how the people were judging their regular, your relatives. If they come to a masjid and some of them don't know the religion, Brelwis, Diobandis, Sufi, Tablighi, they don't know. We have to be easy with those people. But these people were rough with them. Okay, no problem. The big problem in the shahid, when it was time to bury the mother. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. When it was time to bury the mother, the tough brother got in the grave to receive the mother's body. And you know, in your culture, Pakistani Asian culture, you have some respect for the elder. Even if you don't agree with them, you have to respect the elder. As long as he's not doing something crazy, we should listen to him even if you don't agree. The younger one, tough, got into the grave. The elder one, here's his mother too, and he's distraught, and he wants to practice the sunnah, and he wants to put his mother in the grave. He got in the grave, and they started fighting in the grave, in the hole. They were fighting in the hole. While they were fighting in the hole, all of the relatives and the spectators were looking on, and they're saying, this is the sunnah. This is Salafiyah right here. That munkar right there is bigger than what you perceive you're doing. Stopping your brother from getting... That, what's going on is a big, big munkar. You're going to prevent the people from coming to the religion. You're going to prevent the people from coming to the sunnah. Sheikh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, it is said, Allah knows best about the reality of this narration. So I'm not going to mention it as being emphatic. Although it's not a hadith, it is said that when he was making jihad, and Sheikh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he was mashhur, ma'ruf, for al-amr al-ma'ruf and al-nahy al-munkar. He wrote books about it. He has a book called Al-Hisba, the book of people being responsible, policemen being responsible in the Muslim society, taking care of things. It is mentioned that when they were in jihad, in the thagarat, they were in the frontiers making jihad with the Tatars who were new to Islam. Many of them came into Islam. They were drinking khamr. The Tatars, they were Muslims, but their Islam was weak. They were drinking khamr. The man who was with them, his student, another scholar, some individual say, Sheikh, they're drinking khamr. And they're mujahideen. Let's stop them from drinking khamr. Look, there's khamr. He said, no, don't stop them. Let them drink the khamr. But khamr is a kabira from the kaba'ir. It's the al-khaba'ith. It's the major thing. He said, look, if these people stop drinking khamr, if we make this inkar on this munkar, and we take that khamr away, you can rest assured the way these people are, they're going to attack the Muslims. They're going to be a problem for our army. They're going to be a problem for the innocent Muslims. They're going to rape the women. They're going to do problems. So they said that he allowed that issue to take place. I don't know the reality of that story, but it is a qissa that's ma'rufa, mashhura, but it fits under the umbrella of al-Islam. And it doesn't mean that the sheikh was minimizing the evil of khamr or that he was making istihlal of al-khamr. It doesn't mean that at all. It means this principle. If the munkar is going to become bigger, then just leave it. Leave it and don't do anything else. Don't do anything about it. In Egypt, someone went, they burnt a shop where they were selling the movies, the Hollywood, Bollywood, the movies, you know, singing, dancing, Kulthum, them people. They were selling that music and movies. Some of the religious people came and they burnt it down. Petrol, gasoline, burnt it down. They went to jail. Some of them got killed. They came back and they made it nice. They made it out of marble. They rebuilt it real nice and they put two guards over the door. Two guards over the door to protect the thing. You created a munkar bigger than the one that was there. People lost their lives. Nothing was changed. It was fitna. So all of these issues, ikhwani, they require some level of comprehension in the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal. And we ask Allah Ta'ala to teach us what we don't know. So that's our dhikr, our reminder for today. If you brothers have any questions concerning this daras or general questions as well, you can put your question forward.
When groups are resistant to changing their ideologies, what constructive methods can be used to convince them? Yeah, for example, if they're from a Sufi or Rebbe, you advise them, does that mean straight away you start rudding them? Or?
As we mentioned, knowledge is imperative. Allah Azza wa Jal said, when it comes to changing the ideology of people, we first have to understand you don't have the ability to change anything. So when we make al-amr ma'ruf and al-nahi al-munkar, we should understand wa ma ala rasul illa al-balagh. It's your job just to give the message in a good way. In a good way. Innaka la tahdi man ahbabta walakinna Allah yahdi man yasha'u. You, ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you can't guide those who you love. Allah guides those who He wants to guide. It's the first thing. Second thing is, in dealing with people like that, our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was aqil hakim. Udu'u ila sabili rabbika bil hikmati wal mu'idhati al hasanati wa jadilhum billati ya ahsan. Call to the way of your Lord with hikmah. And hikmah is wad'u shayfi mahali, putting things in the right place. Being shadid when shid is the thing to do. Being lean when being soft is the right thing to do. Showing in your actions when that's the right thing to do and so forth and so on. And give dawah with a mu'idha, hasana. You have to give a nice preaching, a nice exhortation, speaking to the points. And jadilhum, and argue with them in a way that is best. So the ayat goes to show that there is some tanawwu'. When you're giving dawah to people, what works for this person may not work for this one. What works for that one may not work for the third one, and so forth and so on. So if you know and you look at the first Rasul who was sent to Bani Adam, Nuh, alayhi salawatullahi wasalamu, alayhi salawatullahi wasalamu. Nuh said to Allah Ta'ala, inni da'autu qawmi laylan wa nahara. I caught them in the daytime, I caught them in the nighttime. I caught them in open, I caught them in secret. Showing, don't always be like this, jam it without any muruna. You have to have flexibility in giving doubt. But flexibility doesn't mean you compromise the truth. Another thing, ikhwani, is persistence. Persistence. Noah gave dawah to his people for 950 years. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave dawah to his people 23 years, 13 years to tawheed. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna ahabb al-a'mali ila Allah ma duwi ma alayhi wa in qalla. The most beloved deed to Allah is the one that is adwamuha, adwamuha wa in qalla, is the one that is persistent, even if it's a little bit. So if you don't win today, if you don't affect them today, you plant the seed, you nurture the seed, you plant water, you pour the water on the seed, you just keep going with your relatives, with your son, with your daughter, with people from these groups. Another issue is a dua. A dua is the silah of the mu'min. The dua is the silah of the mu'min. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made dua for the mother of Abu Hurairah. and she became Muslim. He made dua to Allah Azza wa Jalla for the Islam of Umar, and he became Muslim. He made the dua to Allah Azza wa Jalla for the Islam of many of the people with him, and they became Muslims. The issue is just to keep trying, poking away, and to stay the course. And Allah, my Lord, is A'la and A'la. What takes priority? Al-amr bil-ma'ruf or al-nahyu an al-munkar? Which one is more important? This is one of the philosophical debates that the ulama of al-Islam had, and both sides, they have their dalil and their proofs. So instead of wasting a lot of time or utilizing a lot of time debating which one has priority, because they both have dalil, which one is better? Bani Adam or the Malaika? Both sides, they have their dalil. The scholars, they say, look, al-amr ma'ruf at times has the priority at certain times and places. And at other times and places, al-nahyu an al-munkar, it has its precedence. It takes precedence, and it is what should be focused. So that's part of the hikmah, knowing what should be done and what should be considered first. Good question, Akhi Azhar. What's your name, Akhi? Atif. Both of those individuals, I consider them to be people who you can take your religion from. Muhammad Saleh al-Munajjid was a student of Sheikh Muhammad ibn Saleh ibn Thaymin, and he tries to always reference the vast majority of his fatwas back to what the Sheikhain Kabirain said, Ibn Baz and Ibn Thaymin. Usually that's what he does. In addition to the dalil, not just Sheikh Ibn Baz said this, Ibn Thaymin said that, but he brings the dalil. So that Islamic Q&A, I think, is a bona fide site that you can feel comfortable with going to and referring to. Doesn't mean I agree with everything, but you, anyone else wants to look, it is legit, inshallah. And the other sheikh who you mentioned from Al-Huda, when it comes to answering questions and things like that, we wish that he was on Islam channel. We wish that that individual was exposed more to the English audience, because he also tries to give proofs and so forth and so on. This issue is an issue of ikhtilaf because of what is known as al-istihala. Al-istihala is when something is something is transformed from its original thing to something else, like khamar and vinegar, like water that has feces in it, feces and najasat, but they can do distillation with it and clean it up. Now can you use it for wudu? Can you drink it and so forth and so on? So in these issues, there are technicalities that are going on. So it's an issue of ikhtilaf. As for the pig, it's included in that because it's no longer the pig. So it's included in that. So don't get freaked out by the word pig. Pick, 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 and then we do like that. Has nothing to do with anything. Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned in the Quran, "Hurrimat alaykum al-maytatu wa-dama wa-lahmul khinziri wa ma uhilla li-ghayrillahi bihi." Allah mentioned khinzir in the Quran, and not once did we find the companions doing that, or anything like that. So the word pig, it was a pig over here, Now it became something else, not a pig anymore. So it's included inside of that. It's included inside of that. So it's an issue of ikhtilaf. With those issues, I'm of the opinion, da'ma yuribuka ila ma la yuribuka. Leave what you doubt for what you do not doubt. Leave that gelatin, leave that. Inna al-halal bayyin wa inna al-haram bayyin wa baynahuma umurun mushtabihatun la ya'lamuhunna kathirun min al-nas. So just leave it. You don't have any problems. And Allah, Rabbi, is A'la and A'lam.
We'll stop there. Jazakallah khairan, Akhi Abu Sama. We thank the brothers and sisters for joining us this evening and participating. And inshallah.
Istihala. Istihala is when you make something halal that was haram. It's another word, not istihala. Huh? It's not istihala. I forgot the word. How was it? I'm not sure. Abu Abdurrahman, Isha Kalima Abi? It's not istihala, it's some other word. But the concept is wasn't. I don't think it's istihala. It could be, but I'm not sure. But don't quote me on that. Well, as we mentioned, Akhi, there's always a replacement for something that you avoid. There's always a replacement. You're never going to be stuck like Chuck without another replacement. There's always something else that would take its place where there's no doubt concerning it. May Allah make it easy for us.
In your reminder this evening that the woman's voice was Aura, my question to you is that in the time of the Prophet ﷺ, did the women from the companions not ask questions?
This is true and that is true. The hadith of the Nabi salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi is clear, wadih, bayyin. Qalinna al-mar'ata awra. Idha kharajat istashrafaha ash-shaytanu. He said that the woman is an awra. All of the woman is an awra. And if she goes out, the shaytan beautifies her. It doesn't mean that she can't go out, and it doesn't mean that you can't hear her voice. It doesn't mean that she can't be seen. But it means if she does go out, she has to go out in the best way. وَقَرْنَ فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ وَلَا تَبَرَّجْنَا تَبَرَّجِ الْجَاهِلِيَةِ الْأُولَى. You women should stay in your homes and don't make the display like the times of al-jahiliyyah. In jahiliyyah, she would go out مُعَطَّرَ with perfume on. She would go out and she would walk in the seductive way. She would go out and she wouldn't give the turuqat as haq. So she can go out, but she has to lower her gaze. She has to go out in a particular way. As it relates to her voice, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us when the imam makes a mistake, he said, لِلْرِجَالِ التَّسْبِيحِ وَلِلْنِسَى التَّصْفِيقَ. If the imam makes a mistake, the men say, Subhanallah. And the women should clap. They should clap because their voice is an awra. It shouldn't be heard. But we do have women who came to the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and came to the companions of Khulafa al-Rashideen after him and the other companions radiallahu anhum ajma'een, and they used to make istifta. They used to ask fatwas. The lady came and said, Ya Rasulullah, what if I come and you're not here? You die. He told us sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, iqtadi billadhini min ba'di Abi Bakr wa Umar. Then look for Abu Bakr, look for Umar, follow them. Many, sometimes they would ask questions that were even muhraja. They were embarrassing and sensitive. Sensitive questions about how to make ghusl and things like that. So it is permissible for the woman to ask questions in public. It is permissible in the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal. But again, it has its dawabit. And from the dawabit, إذا أمنت الفتنة. If there's not going to be any fitna, then it's permissible. If it's going to be fitna, then she shouldn't do it. She shouldn't even return the salams. Someone gives the salams, she shouldn't even return the salams if there's going to be fitna, not to mention talking out. And that's why we ask the ladies, you write this stuff down, so forth, so on. But if she were to ask out loud, it's not haram. As long as there's no fitna, and Allah Azza wa Jal, Rabbi, is A'la and A'lam.